Hello.
Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. So we're a team or Oracle. That's the Facebook mission statement, part of it right there. We got really inspired by that. We came to Facebook and built a messaging app for real. Deja vu, as the French guy would say. So yesterday, the three of us were discussing, and we noticed that between us, we use Facebook or texting for the majority of our messages, 80% of it or more. But there are some times when we don't really feel comfortable using that medium because sometimes we're too sensitive about a topic, or sometimes we're afraid that we may not get the most honest answers if we choose that. So for that reason, we came up with a new concept.
Introducing Oracle. So Oracle is that platform that provides you this opportunity to ask those questions and talk about those topics that you really want to address with your circles of friends, but in an anonymous way, right? So what it does, essentially, it's a tool where you can broadcast a question or topic to your circles of trusted, your trusted network, so your friends, essentially. And they don't know who it's from, and they'll be able to actually answer you in an anonymous way, right? So I'd like to walk you through it in the demo right here. As you can see, there's my questions on top. And so I just ask a simple question or start a topic. And my friends, who I don't know who they are going to answer back in a different color. So I actually get to interact with, in an anonymous way, with people that I know that are part of my trusted network, but I don't know exactly who they are. All right? So let me give you a simple example for you to understand. So I have a big crush on Jess, and I really want to know if she's single, right? But I do want to ask my friends, but not directly, because I might, you know, get embarrassed if they tell me that she's already with somebody or she doesn't like small, you know, like small guys like me. So I'm going to use this app to actually broadcast to my trusted network if Jess is single or not, and have the opportunity to have some insights from my friends if they already know something. So if you can see, I could go right in and type. We could also broadcast some photos. That could be cool. And I get the chance to actually have some smart data about the questions I just ask from my trusted network, without being embarrassed or shy, right, from the get-go. So, all right, I'll give you another example. So I work at Facebook, and I'm having a blast. It's awesome. But I just got this amazing offer from Microsoft, and so I just don't know what to do, right? And I want to ask my friends, for some advice. But I just don't want them to know that I'm hesitating and that I'm actually considering it. But I really want to have their opinion. So again, I'll use Oracle to ask them in an anonymous way, and they can provide me some insightful answers. So this is like the premise of this interaction in anonymous with my trusted circle of friends.
So yeah, that's Oracle in a nutshell. We mentioned just two of the use cases, but the possibilities are infinite. This could work not just for individuals, but also for companies and groups where they want feedback and interaction. Not all places have as open a culture as Facebook, so it would come really handy there. This will be our first app in the Windows App Store, so we're really excited about this. And thank you, Facebook and Microsoft, for having us. Thanks.
How do you get the answers? Like, you post all these anonymous questions, and it just puts a stream of like random responses.
So basically, it sends notifications to your friends. They don't know who it came from. They just know it's someone from their Facebook's friend list. We had only one device, so we had predefined answers from multiple Facebook accounts.
Okay.
And the thread color tells you that certain messages are from one user, but you don't know who exactly.
And so it's obviously not sending Facebook notifications.
No. It's all in-app for now.
Very hard to make it anonymous. Yes. Okay. That's cool.
Anything platform level that you consider that might be make it more appealing and useful to end users?
Something in the We use Parse and Facebook, of course. We're using the Facebook ID for on the back end to keep track of which thread belongs to who, and so that the anonymity of both the parties are maintained. And on the front end, we want to keep it super intuitive, so you're sure that everything is private and you're just typing messages. In general, all of Windows Phone platform is super intuitive, so we kind of tried to keep that style. We looked at the interfaces of some other chat apps and
you get negative points for sucking up. go ahead.
Okay. So did I answer your question?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, I have one question. Can you show showcase through your app how the login process actually works?
Can you showcase how the login process actually works and how the user gets to the chat page?
Okay. Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Didn't save the session. I'm just going to for demo purpose, but yeah. We could have saved it. Basically, we just use we were using the Parse login API, the one which allow you to call the login async function and get the token after calling the function. I will use that one to authenticate the user and get do the queries based on the token we got from the query. Yeah.
One more addition, we don't have a logout feature, but every time you relaunch the app right now, you have to connect and create a new session with Facebook. We also made a Windows tablet app in JavaScript, but it's not fully functional. This is the only fully functional part on the mobile.
So are you going to continue to develop this app?
Yeah, for sure. At the very least, we'll get another Windows phone from Nokia. No, this is really new. We've made stuff on the iOS platform. This is new. Like it was mentioned yesterday, there's just way too much room to grow here than on other platforms currently. So that excites me.
Why did you pick this idea as opposed to whatever? Like, how did you come up with this idea?
Okay. Are you talking about the implementation of the idea specifically?
Yeah, like you could have hacked a lot of different things, right?
And I think the anonymous aspect is very interesting because it might sound like not so appealing or not very interesting, but as we can see in chat, like it's very very used as Rajab mentioned. But there's some verticals or some specificities in chat that can be explored further. And specifically here, we've choose to focus on the anonymous part because it actually we can all relate to examples I just mentioned. So in a way it brings some value in our day-to-day life, and if it's implemented well, it can be really interesting on the platform.
Cool. One more addition to that, two of us are developers. We're not exactly the most outgoing people on the planet. We usually are very shy, so this is something we relate to. That's another motivation.
Oh, one question. What was the most difficult thing to implement this?
So Tao can expand upon this. We're new to this platform. It took a while to figure out. On iOS, a lot of things can be done natively. But in here, we had to build some things from scratch. But we had great help from all the developers here. Tao, you want to expand on that?
Yeah, I feel like, I think Facebook is not supporting like as much as he's doing for other platforms, like iOS or Android. So for sometimes, we have to build some native UIs for the Windows Phone 8, like some controllers by ourselves. Say like if you are going to, like you want to build a friend picker, and you can just get the one directly from Facebook if you are building for platforms like Android or iOS. However, if you are building for Windows Phone 8, you have to like write the code by yourself, which is like harder to do. And there's, I mean, also other issues with generally, I feel like the Parse API is not as fully, it's not about function, but it's not, does not have as many functionalities as the one you found in Android. So when we are doing the query, we have some limitations.
All right.
Also, as Dhiren knows, we tried almost 100 times to get push to work, but it failed to work on all platforms for a certain period in the night. I cannot promise that we didn't break it, but we think we didn't break it.
All right, it's possible. Thanks, that was pretty awesome.
Thanks.
Hey, how's it going? I'm Lance. This is Vikram and Kirill. And we just kind of met up last night, definitely hacked some stuff together. So what we built is a social Pomodoro app. Does everybody know what the Pomodoro technique is? So for those of you that don't, it's basically like a time management kind of behavior or habit.
Yeah, for
and it
people,
utilizes
people who get distracted, like, you know, me a lot. And, so it helps you stay focused 25 minutes at a time.
Yeah, and if you're anything like me, I'm very ADD, so I have trouble staying focused on a particular task at hand. And also, you know, if you work in a startup or you work in close proximity to your workmates, it's often hard sometimes because someone's leaning over you and, you know, say, hey, can you help me with this problem or can you help me with that? So so basically we set up a task list, a timer, and then a Facebook integration, which Vikram's pulling up right now.
Yes.
And what so this does is this has a... you see a timer over there on Jennifer Chan, and basically that's telling me that I shouldn't interrupt Jennifer for the next 14 and a half minutes because she's right in the middle of a task. And I also can broadcast my timer to my friends and let them know to not bother me for, you know, 24 minutes or whatever. So that way I can stay focused on the task at hand and really knock out some quality work. So we also set up an invite function there with the Facebook API so we can invite our friends, especially our really annoying friends who always bug us and don't let us get any work done. We can invite them and just let them know that we're busy. We also set up a little task list to help us plan out our day or plan the tasks that we're actually going to work on. And so, yeah, just like a free text field right there, and then you can go ahead and check off those tasks when you're done with them. And put as many tasks there on the screen as you'd like. So my timer's running down here. Let me show you some of the mobile screens that we mocked up. We weren't able to get the push notifications and some of the other functionalities into the app last night. But we did have a couple mobile screens that we were working on for you know, for porting this over to Windows Phone. So this kind of shows a little more refined timer setup and kind of the what you'd be broadcasting to your friends.
Yeah, and you could also be, you know, maybe interested in setting up alarms. So suppose you want to know when a friend is, like, you know, almost ready to go and play table tennis or something. You can you know, put an alarm on that person's, like, free time, and maybe ask him a question or something after that.
And what you're seeing there is the alarm up top there has been selected, and then the one below has not been. So
the task list can be more elaborate and interesting.
Yeah, and these are some icons that we wanted to integrate as well. And then right here on this would be kind of the main screen. And up top you see kind of four little tomatoes there. And part of the Pomodoro technique advises you to set up kind of like four blocks of 25 minutes. And after the first block, you would take a 5-minute break, and then after the fourth, you would take like a 15 or 20 minute break.
And around the platform, so Windows 8 has all these features like live tiles and push notifications, which could be really useful in an app like this, and even maybe on a lock screen of you know, of a phone. So,
Do we have the phone there?
Yeah, phone and it's locked.
Worry about this for a second.
Yeah, so this is like a, you know, Pomodoro thing mock-up that we were doing on phone also. Yeah.
All right. So that's about it. You guys have any questions for us?
Yeah. Is the concept new?
It's definitely not a new concept. It's kind of a incremental improvement of an existing idea.
What's the incremental?
What's incremental is it's socialized. So the Pomodoro technique has mostly been just a self, you know, time management thing. And over here, and there are some which are really elaborate and maybe like Kanban oriented, but this one is pretty much, you know, it's social. It is the Pomodoro technique is typically, you know, personal, but over here it adds that element of,
in a group setting, in a you know company office or something like that, you can actually coordinate your free time, and that's as important as coordinating your work time for your breaks and stuff.
Absolutely. And then another thing we were thinking about is kind of 37 Signals approach to doing business. Like, they're all about uninterrupted time. They don't check their email. You know, they just do these blocks of work. So integrating the social aspects, you know, make it very useful in a work setting.
So, how do you get all your friends to actually go along with this thing?
Well, it's probably a lot like all the other annoying app, you know, requests that you get. Just send out a bunch of invites and see what happens. I mean, if it's like a team that you're working with, I mean, especially here in Silicon Valley and like the startup environment.
So I didn't have to. When we were like working in the startup location, and when I told him about it, it appealed to him to even develop it together, not just be invited for the app. It made a lot of sense for teams that work really hard together, don't want to be interrupted. This is something that they would be interested in.
So it's something that I can see it working in a team setting, because you have maybe a manager or somebody, and you kind of agree to it all. But if you're just like working on your own, I can't imagine any of my friends like not interrupting me.
Yeah, I mean, you would have to be in a place where you have a team going on. Basically,
that's probably where the most value for it is. Like at this stage of our iterations.
Do you have any ideas in the work environment how it would integrate with any other tools or anything like that?
Well, there could definitely be other social integration options for sure.
Yes. So as I mentioned, there's some like bigger project management tools involving Kanbans, and where you kind of can share your work pieces, and they actually have visual, interaction of, how much work's been completed. And
Basecamp would be a killer integration, just right off the top.
Could Team 5 make their way to this podium to get set up for the next presentation? Team 5?
Should I wait? Are you guys? Okay. Hi. So I'm Jason Custer, and I made Party Host. What is Party Host, you ask? Well, so you're making a party. You want to have a party. You want to have a couple of your friends over, and you want to sit around by your pool, listen to some music, eat some food, and have a good time. But your question is, what music do you play? Music is really a very personal thing. Everybody has different music tastes. Everybody likes different things. One person's great music choice is something that someone else completely hates. So you wind up with sort of a prickly situation where you're trying to come up with a playlist for a party, and you don't really know what you should pick. So Party Host started out of sort of that idea of what do you do at a party so that all of your friends can be happy. So I developed Party Host, which is for the Windows Phone platform, and uses the Facebook client API. And so as you can see on the screen, we have Party Host. There's a little festive party hat. And so what we're going to do is we're going to log in with Facebook. But we're going to walk through the tutorial first. So here we go. We have step one. And I'm going to read it off because it's a little bit grainy on that screen. So upon logging in, you'll be presented with this screen. You'll click the plus at the bottom of the screen to get started. So you say what type of party you're hosting. I'm hosting a pool party. It's called Super Duper Awesome Party. For this party, we're going to need music and TV shows. We're going to have the TV running inside the house for people who don't want to be by the pool. And we're going to have some music playing over the stereo system. And then we're going to get the party from our events list. So I've created a Facebook event, and I've invited all of my friends to it, and they've all accepted because they all like me. And so we're going to go, and we're going to get my list of events. My list of events is a little bit sparse right now because, yeah, whatever. But so you, nobody actually likes me. It's OK. But so you will then go and navigate to the event that you want, and you will click on it, and it will download all of the people who are responded as going to that event, and will download all of the likes of whatever categories you suggested. So the four categories are music, TV, games, and movies. So it will download all of the likes that your friends have of those. And so it'll go through and download for each person in the group, and then gives you a list. And here is the list, a bunch of music, and on the next pivot, there'll be a bunch of TV. And I can show you this. And then step 6 and 7, we're going to actually see in action. So here, we're gonna log in with Facebook. We're logged in, and we're gonna host a quiet get-together. What are we gonna call this quiet get-together? Friends. That's a nice title. For this party, let's say we're gonna have some music and some movies going on, and we're going to create the party from our friends list. Let's party. So right now, you can see at the top, it's downloading our list of friends. So I'm just gonna go here and check a bunch of people. So this is another option. If you do not have an event set up, but you want to create a party, you can just go ahead and check a whole bunch of people, and it will go ahead and create something for you. Party. So it's downloading people. It's pretty speedy about it. I would have put in threading, but that would have taken me hours and hours, and that was just not something that I wanted to do. So it's finished downloading, and that is fascinating. So we're going to go back here, and we're going to choose something that already has some stuff in it, because this is a demo, and things always go wrong in the demo. So here's a list of music and TV. So you can see here's a bunch of music artists that a bunch of the people that I selected like. And here's a bunch of TV shows that they like. So I can choose those for my app, or for my party. And so one of the other features is you can click on here. And here we have The Killers, a popular music group. I clicked on Start Radio Mix. And using the Nokia Music API, we've now started a mix of The Killers. So from music that our friends liked, from the things that that were personal to them, we have now created a mix that will make everyone happy at the party. And so I'm Jason. This has been all the sleep has. This has been Party Host. I've been up for 26 hours, and thank you very much.
So how are you deciding which music or TV to show? Is it just what all of the friends like, or is it the things that are most common? Or?
Yeah, it's it downloads all of their likes and aggregates them and sorts them. So what you saw there was the list of most liked items. I had a little graphic that showed how much people liked it, but it broke at the last minute, and I figured that putting together a demo was more important.
Sure.
But so yeah, it's what the most number of people like, and so you get pretty good results.
So is the mix strictly from specific things that your friends like, or does it make any guesses for?
So the mix works off of Nokia's mix radio, where it takes the artist and it looks at artists like that artist. Other artists in the genre, a whole bunch of other factors, songs that are like that artist, and builds up a radio station from that. So it's not just going to play through like the discography of The Killers. You're going to get a whole bunch of other music as well.
Does it exclude the ones that are already in the list?
It does not exclude the ones that are already in the list. And a feature that I'm considering including going forward is, I believe in the Nokia Mixed Radio API, you can thumbs down songs. And so things that like only one or two people liked, or that like I could do some sort of like trend analysis and figure out genres that nobody liked and thumbs down songs in those genres so that they would be less likely to occur.
What are some of the most challenging things that you faced while making this app?
Staying awake. But other than that, so I had the problem with the download time. It was taking a very long time to download all of the users because it sets up a download for every time. And I was trying to do threading, but threading is a very hard problem, and my operating system is like jangling in the back of my head with like cross-thread access and that sort of thing. But so that was something that I sort of beat my head against for a while, and it wound up working out okay. I made a loading graphic that looks nice and sort of fills the user in on what's going on and makes them feel like they're a part of what's going on in that process. So.
Leo.
Hey, so I'm Brian, and I'm just wondering, how many of you have heard about an app called Tinder before on iPhone and Android? Really, that's it. Okay, so Tinder is for, it's a new dating app where it's really low cost of entry. All you have to do is take a look at people's photos that are located near you, and then you just swipe left or right if you like the photo or if you don't like the photo. So what we've done is we created a Tinder app for Windows Phone because there currently isn't one, so. Here's the app.
Oh, went straight in.
Went straight in. That's okay.
Don't want to log out?
Yeah, log out. Okay. Settings.
So that's how we log in.
Go for it. Okay, so obviously we're using Tinder servers, so we didn't have to do any of that work, so it kind of helped us out quite a bit. And they use Facebook extensively, so we're kind of piggybacking on top of that. Beginning with the Facebook login, so you can go ahead and do that. And then we're immediately starting to pull in your Facebook profile, so we're showing you your profile photo there. And then, let's give it a second.
This phone's been taking a while.
Must be a lot of people nearby. Hold on. It'll happen. Trust me.
This phone's been weird all day.
In a second, you'll see that it's going to come up, and it'll show you somebody's photo.
As it did before.
It's going to happen. It's been getting slower and slower. I think the Tinder's realizing that I just keep logging in and doing all this testing and stuff on their servers, and they seem to be rate limiting me, slowing me down as I go. But give it a second. I don't know. Close the app. Try to reopen it.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to give it another second.
Or just go to the home screen and just start it over because we logged out. Yeah. Maybe that was it. Let's try it again. Hopefully this works better. And because I've already logged in with Facebook, you're not seeing the actual Facebook login. We're not using the new Facebook.
Brian.
There we go. So then you can go ahead and let's see this photo. Yeah, you can. Let's. We like that one.
Like, you want to like it? All right.
So you can just swipe it and like it. If you don't like it, you can swipe it to the other direction. Or you can click the buttons down and below. You can see those icons tell you how many photos they have. So go ahead and click the eye. Let's take a look at the next person's information. You can see that's getting pulled in from Facebook right there. So those are the likes that we both share in common with each other. So you can swipe the photo and see their other photos. And then why don't we go into my profile? So go ahead and go into, yeah. And then click on that main image. Let's change that out. And then this is going to pull in all of the photos from Facebook that have your you in the picture, and then you can change it. Don't select one, though, because it's not working yet. So you can just back out of there. And then if both of you like each other, then you get to talk to each other. So go ahead and you can open up the conversations panel. And then so as long as you both match, then you can talk to each other. You can go ahead and open one. Not one of the ones I'm actually talking to, though. And then you can just kind of have a text message conversation, but you don't get to know their last name. You don't get to know exactly where they live, so it's still semi-anonymous. So obviously it's a great idea. Tinder's doing very well on iPhone and Android, and it just seems, you know, right that it should also be on Windows Phone. So that's what we've done.
So did you do all of this yesterday?
Well, so the actual data layer I had done previously, and I open sourced it and released it. So we're just kind of piggybacking on top of that. The UI is all done for this hackathon, yeah.
Do you find it very easy to build on XAML animation transitions and
We've been doing messaging a lot with Windows Phone. It's kind of our full-time job, so we're pretty comfortable with it.
How will you prevent them from suing you?
I don't think we could, but this will probably get open source too, and then if somebody else wants to take it further, then they could. But you're right, I think that there might be lawsuits in the future if you tried to go too far with this. Well, we couldn't use the actual new Facebook login, because we're kind of using a backdoor because we're using their Facebook app. So we are using the web Facebook login. So we're just redirecting to the authentication URL with their client ID. And then we're getting back an auth token and we're passing it off to their servers. And they just kind of assume that everything's kosher. So we can't actually do the new Facebook login because it wouldn't allow it to redirect back into our app. So that's our workaround.
And did you implement the messaging?
Excuse me?
Did you implement the messaging?
The messaging works.
And what does it use?
Tinder. I mean, we're using their server. So are you mean for the UI?
No. The backend platform
for the
messaging.
Yeah, I mean everything server side. We're just relying on Tinder servers, so they've implemented the messaging. Basically, this app, it looks very similar to the iPhone app, and it functions almost identically to the iPhone app in terms of how it pulls the server for new messages and things. We tried to make it look, you know, so that they couldn't detect that it wasn't the iPhone app. So. No, there's no push notifications because that isn't really feasible. I mean, in the future, I think that the best thing that you could do would be a background agent, and you could have it pull in the background for new messages and then update the live tile. But push notifications wouldn't really be doable since it's their server. Thanks.
Hello. We're Team 6, iNaturalist. So iNaturalist.org is a website that builds a community around amateur naturalists. So you can go to the website and either with an app or I think directly from the computer, you can upload a picture of some creature or plant that you've seen out in the wild, and people around the world will tell you what it is and give you information about it, and vice versa. You can go to the, if you have particular knowledge about certain plants or animals, you can help other people figure out what they're seeing. So what we've done is we have started building an app for the Windows Phone to to interface with the iNaturalist website. There's already an Android and iPhone version. And there, as you can see, we have the Facebook login implemented, which takes you to the main. The other way, make it smaller. So what we have here is once you log into the site, then you can get observations from the. So that should be picking up observations locally from the. So these are observations that people have made locally that they're looking for specific information or pointing out something that they think is cool. We didn't actually have time to integrate both of our pieces of code, so now we'll move to the other phone. What I was mostly working on was the guts of it, and Gilles was working on the UI. So here he's showing that if you took a picture, what you can do is select a picture from your camera roll, add text and that sort of thing, text or questions or whatever. It's geotagged and then uploaded to the iNaturalist site, where other people will be able to comment on the picture. The iNaturalist is actually, it's an open source project. We'd like to finish this and get it in the store. It's a pretty cool site if anyone wants to go there. Also, we'd love to have other people work with us on this if they want to. But so that's the Windows Phone iNaturalist.
Can you review you said this was open source, so you already had a piece of this, which parts did you work on?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. What we did, we did all this here today. The website is all a project on GitHub, and so, even the website and the Android and the iPhone versions of it, but they don't have a Windows phone, so all this is what we did today.
What were some of the kind of biggest challenges you encountered while you were building this?
I think the dealing with the JSON. I mean, getting a giant JSON download and then trying to figure out how to use that is it's tricky. I mean, there are some of the online tools to do that, like JSON2 C#. For example, but it's. I don't think there's any clean way to do it. You just have to sort of wade your way through the.
Did you try integrating Viewfinder into your app so that you don't have to pick up a picture from the camera roll?
Oh, you can actually take a picture through the app, but I didn't want to take a picture of all you guys and. Because who knows what people would have said, right? both. You can either take a picture through the app or choose one from the roll.
Mm-hmm. So what is the relevance of Facebook login to this app?
We just use the basic login, the new login. Mm-hmm. So, it doesn't do, at this point, doesn't do anything more complicated than that. They do have it. We didn't integrate it with that specifically, but they do use it from their website.
Yeah. Thank you.
Team 8, please come up to the podium so we can set up your presentation. Thank you.
So our app is called Settle Me Not, and I'm Arup, and he's Biswa. So I have a question, how many of us have had to move frequently because of job or work? So essentially, this is catering to those kind of people. And we have to search apartment. So the first floor shows how we go about searching for an apartment. And once we go and then log in, and then it's we put the city we are interested in, and then that shows us like a list of rate, apartment rate, and the address. So this essentially gives you what are the apartments and how much each costs. So you can make a decision how to go about. So this is just one flow of it, and the other one which tells about, let's say, so this is the way how your app has some intelligence and tries to find an apartment for you. Another way is you ask your friends a question, saying like, what's a good what's a good gaming arcade in Milpitas? So that question is typed, and your friends see it in your wall, and then they reply to it. While if it's a big question, it might take a little bit of time to come. And then it shows up in your timeline, and then your friend answers, okay, so something like, let's say, Dave and Buster's or something. So this way, you have your friends answer questions, and so which the part which we couldn't implement was we wanted to write a FQL statement where you'll find out which friends have answered most of your questions, and then you can rank them. So these two different parts of the app try to essentially get you the best answers, either using machine or person. And we are actually, he's an Android programmer and I'm more Java, so it's really the, it's been like just this hackathon we learned how to code and stuff. Other than that, I think, yeah, we use REST APIs from apartment listing to find the addresses. We used like Trulia or something of that sort. I think, yeah, that's pretty much it.
What will you do with the, like, say you, a bunch of people reply in the post? Then what will the app do? What's the expected behavior of the app?
Once a bunch of people reply to you, then you just take the comments and use NLP, which is, of course, we haven't implemented, to find the best, like the veracity of the comment with respect to the context, and then use that to rank your friend. So this is among your friend. And then in kind of similar questions, which where the context is similar, in case it's like a gaming arcade and you have few leaders from each friend list answer, and so you can rank them based on their accuracy, how good they provide answers.
How do you measure that?
It's NLP, so you just use certain algorithms, which I mean I haven't yet used.
So it seems like some of this is, if it's something factual, it's easy. You can like somehow come out and rank it and stuff. But what if it, like, what's the best arcade in Milpitas? Like, that's could be very like pretty wide range of opinions on that, right? So how will you like try to filter out the best of the responses?
So again, it's you can either use based on your best friend and then based on that, or you can classify the reply of your friend versus a lot of field data, and then if that there's a correlation, and then you kind of go about that. I mean the algorithm does that, which of course we couldn't do it in one day, so but that's the idea.
All right, everyone, can you hear me? All right, so how many people here use or have heard of Eventbrite?
Okay, quite a bit. And how many people here know of Facebook? All right, so I basically am trying to merge both, and you can list your events from one to the other. So here's the events app. You do login with Facebook, takes you to the Facebook app, will ask for permissions. I'd already given it permissions earlier, so here are all my events near me, not my events, here are events near me found on Eventbrite that I'm listing on this page. So you can see, you know, if you're interested in an event and you want to share it with your friends, you will pick an event, and you keep noticing in the background, I can get directions, like driving directions to the event, or I can also list the event as an event on Facebook. So I will press this button. It will list it on event, so it's successfully listed. And you can see in the background here, I get a notification on Facebook saying your event has been listed. And here's the event. Here's the event with the location and everything, all the details about the event. So people can now start responding to your event on Facebook as well. Let me just pick another random event here and bring it up. So I can also list an event as a timeline feed item on my page. So I will do that. And now it's listed on my timeline. So if I refresh this, you will see the event has been listed right there on top. So I just listed this event using my app, Social Events. And now people can like, if you're running events, they can like your events and respond to your comments here as well. So that is what I've been able to get in the hackathon. But the goal is you can basically make your events more social across the web. And whether you are running the event or you are going to an event, you can let your friends know, hey, I'm coming there, and your friends can join you. Or if it's your event, you can post it as an event, and people can buy tickets on Facebook as well. So right now, this is the functionality. I want to add more details on like live tiles on Windows phones. You can see, you know, your next event coming up and get reminders for those. And I think, yeah, that's the functionality for the app.
Okay. I don't know much about Eventbrite, but wouldn't Eventbrite be the right app to be doing this? Just as a thought, you know. Any event system would basically want to integrate with Facebook events or any.
Yeah, but Eventbrite doesn't have an app on the Windows phone. So you can't do that. And, you know, even in there, I think official apps on iOS and Android, I don't see integration with Facebook yet. So that's something you can do here.
How do you, it seems like if I was interested in an event and I shared it, now I have two places where I have to check.
Yes. One of the things I was trying to implement was basically a link from the event here saying, here are the details of the event, here's the time, here's the location, but to purchase the ticket, you go to a certain link, like the Eventbrite link. But I tried passing in a link into the description, but it doesn't like it. It didn't make it as a link. So I need to get that somehow figured out. But I remember, like, when I was talking to you yesterday, there was really not even a way to get an event across, and then we figured out, right?
Yeah, this is new to me.
Yeah, see? So to post an event on Facebook.
But, I mean, I think the other thing is, one day, if I would, like, use an app like this, the value would be more, like, I don't want to go to five different places. Your app should just tell me.
Sorry?
Just aggregate all the information from, like, there might be some other event.
Yeah. So another thing could be actually, you know, pull in events from multiple sources in the app, pull in events from current events from Facebook and Eventbrite and, you know, wherever other websites, and pull them in one location. You can see all the events and then share, hey, I'm going to this event, just kind of thing, status updates or, you know.
So what is the major use case you're trying to solve? I mean, it could be multiple, but like the main thing is what? It's the inconvenient, like you saw an event on Eventbrite and your friends might not know about it.
Yeah.
Is it that, or do you think the main value is
Like, I just want to manage all my events from one place, from all these different locations.
So I mean, there are two aspects to this. One is the organizer aspect, and one is the attendee aspect. From an organizer aspect, you might want to manage your events, right? So if you have events that you host on Eventbrite or even on Facebook, you can pull them together in one and maybe see attendee lists, you know, users who said, I'm going to the event, and then check them in, or, you know, so. From an attendee perspective, it'll be a little bit of both. A, you want to see the events that you want to sign up for in one place, and then it's more like, you know, once you sign up for the event, it automatically posts a status on your feed saying, I'm going to this event. So your friends know you're going to this, you know, and they can click a link and sign up too.
Does your implementation pull any updates from the event or poll to see if anything's changed or people have RSVP'd or anything like that?
So in this implementation, it does pull in the updates to the event, not the attendee part of it, just the event updates. So, but doesn't like pull in a list of attendees right now. But that's, I think, easy to implement further, yeah. All right, cool, thank you.
Team 10, please meet up to the podium, please. Thank you.
Hi. it's my turn, right? Okay. I came with an idea, but my developer wasn't able to make it. Yesterday, they talked about that you could also use the, what you call, the App Studio. So I heard about this App Studio a while ago. I read an article. I kind of browsed through it. Didn't really find too much interesting for what I do. But since yesterday I heard that that could be an option, then I started experimenting with it. I thought that would be a good way to spend my time here. And actually, I was pretty impressed. I read an article first and feared that you're able to pull data from RSS and that's a great way to connect what I do, which is web development, with the actual app without having to regenerate the app many times. So I was able to kind of just generate a quick app where I can show, what is this? Oh, here, okay. Where I can show the products from my client. In a way that you know you can watch it. You know how apps are faster for browsing, and usually when at least for this type of client, people that are obsessed with cars. So some people that are obsessed with antiques, and this is a type of clientele that I know my client usually deals with. And I think an app will be a good fit to showcase his products as well. So yeah, that's pretty much what I did. It's nothing fancy. I noticed that it's pretty much based on gathering the information from the RSS and displaying it in a way that I could probably put more options to it, such as linking for PayPal, maybe integrate the Facebook. But I don't think I'm going to be able to use Facebook here, right? Not at all. Yeah. But we'll have some time to do that from scratch later on. So for me, this worked perfectly. It's something that I use, thought that would be a good idea to spend the time on. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
I think you can still use Facebook. I mean, these are objects. They are some nouns.
Yeah, I spend a lot of...
a person can take an action on any object.
I didn't know you could actually edit other than the options that are here. I mean, I saw a lot of interesting options, like you could get feeds from Facebook, I mean, YouTube, Flickr. I had some issues with the images. I guess the data types, when I'm doing an import from RSS, I don't know. At the end, it kind of worked, and I'm pretty sure I can figure it out later, which is what, you know. But for now, I think something to show is cool. And it was a good experience because it's a hack, so you didn't have to write any code, you know? So that's it.
Is the use case, what is the is it you were trying to go specifically for like high priced unique items or what does the major?
Well, no, basically, we have a CMS that we usually use for e-commerce site that we developed. And the idea is if we're offering, you know, if we're making sites with that CMS, then might as well just have a few options, checkboxes, so that you could also push that to the app if you want. But it could be any type of product. It just whoever client decides to get a new e-commerce site with us, and we'll give them the option to showcase that on an app. That would be cool. And then they can also purchase it, and eventually we can develop the login with the credit card stuff that you guys are coming out with. That'll be kind of cool too. Yeah. Yeah. That's it. Cool.
Could team 13 make their way to podium number 2 over here? Team 13, please. Thank you.
How do I switch to computer first? Can I get the mic?
Hi guys, we came with a ready concept of our service, which is called StuffDM. It's a cross-platform service that is kind of a mix of news reading platform and entertainment platform, and it's already available for a couple of platforms. And we came with a ready app available. It's not yet available for Windows Phone, and we wanted to integrate seamless single sign-on in there. Can we switch to Windows Phone now? So I guess we're not competing for the prizes because we already have the app developed, but we have implemented SSO here. So let me log out and show how it works. Settings and log out. There is a landing page with all the features that advertise why you need to sign in. And after that, SSO comes through and you're back in the app. And you could start reading news. So what the app actually does is it lets you to subscribe to your favorite news channels. And after that, you could, it's basically an RSS reader. And once you start liking things, it creates a profile. And you get followers, like on Instagram. And there are plenty of animated GIFs that people like and profiles out there. So the focus of our development today was to implement things like friend invites. So let's say I'm going into a friend list here. How do I do that? Oops. Yeah, and once I get my friend list loaded, which takes a while, I've got a couple of thousand friends, I could press a button and open up a dialogue which will say login. At this time, there are some things like missing, you couldn't pass a token in the dialogue, and we're working with Facebook team here to resolve that. unfortunately, it times out at this moment. So we have implemented a couple of features here and there, like open graph functionality, so things that you subscribe to are being actually posted. And you could actually pull the data from Facebook, like the subscriptions of people, what they already subscribed. So plenty of things here and there. And we're just trying to align the functionality with other platforms where most of where all of the stuff already works. And it was a great pleasure to meet development team and get and provide our feedback and get the roadmap for all those features. Yeah, well, I guess that's it. Yeah.
Well, I had a question. You said you had difficulty getting a lot of friends. Is there are ways to do it? Have you explored them? Like, what did you try? I'm trying to look at.
Yeah. Well, typically it works, but. I guess something wrong. Obviously, we're doing pagination and we're doing progressive loading on all the platforms, and it's not a problem. I'm not sure why it doesn't work right now. Should be probably just stuck. We need to fix some bugs here.
I saw the Facebook API had pagination and.
Yeah, sure, it works across all the platforms where it's not the first steps that we have developed.
Sure.
What was kind of the biggest challenge that you had implementing? I don't know if you want to speak even to the whole app or just to the stuff that you got to work on here, but
Yeah, we discussed all the problems with Facebook team. So mostly it was like things, figuring out which dialogues already work or not, what's up in the roadmap, and how to handle SSO, like log out, and just checking all the modes of like mobile web signing if the app is not installed. So going through all those checklists of making sure this is a product quality ready app that will work like everywhere without a kink. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, hi everyone. I'm Ishai, this is Mehmet. We're from Kebab Labs, and we have this game called Masters of Trivia. And our goal for this weekend was to add some social features to it. So this is the way our sign-up looked before. It was just a nickname sign-up. And this is what it is now. So you can sign in with Facebook, or if you don't want to, you can use your email. And you can also play as a guest. Now we're going to sign in with the Facebook. What are you doing? OK, let's use this one. Okay, so in this one, I already gave permission for Facebook, so I'm just gonna say FB, and sign up. We're planning on using Facebook to get your list of friends, so you can see how you rank against your friends. Right now, it's real time against everyone, so it's an online trivia game, and the idea is to add social features where you can see how you rank against your friends. When your friends are playing, you can get a notification so you can play against them in real time, and lots of other stuff, I guess, we can do with social. So that's it. They basically just added the social login. That whole screen is a new screen, as you can see.
So what are the use cases once you get your friends? Like, what are all the things
I can't hear what you're saying.
What are the use all once you get the list of friends and everything? What are all the things you want to do with it?
So the first thing is we have this weekly masters competition, and then the high scores at the end of each game. But also, there's this weekly competition. So we want to add another tab here that shows you how you rank against your friends this week, so you can kind of get some bragging rights. So that's one thing. The other thing is you can invite friends and do a heads-to-heads against them. It's not a real heads-to-heads. It's real-time with everybody else, but you'll see that as a separate list of you and your friends. And also, just you can get notified when they're playing. So you don't actually have to do an invite specifically. It's just whenever your friends are playing, you can kind of get a little notification and join in. But the game itself is everybody just sees the same game always, even the ones who are not your friends.
Everybody, we are team
Cypher.
Test. Can you hear me? We are team Marathon, and our app is Cypher Chat. Congratulations to all the people who are still awake. There were very few, I think, made it through the whole. There's a guy. 18 hours. It's been fun. So I'm Ryan.
Mohammed.
Meher. All right. So sorry, I'm a little. Brain dead. The premise of this is to trust nobody. I've actually forgot to put Microsoft on the slide. Sorry. You're not important enough. right. And so we were actually chatting last night at around 9 or 10 p.m. trying to figure out what the heck we're going to do. One idea was to keep track of who you haven't messaged on Facebook and then we realized that was lame. That also.
We don't want to reverse engineer the API, so. Yeah, there is no APIs for that. But it was fun to know who's online, right?
Right.
But then we took a new spin, right?
So then we talked about encryption for a sec, and we were thinking there's no encryption library that supports off the record. If you guys have heard of OTR, it's a pretty popular library for encryption. There's an ADM plugin, there's a Pigeon plugin, there's a proxy for AIM.
None of them for Windows.
None of them worked on Windows 8.1. So we said, let's just hack that to last night or today.
We had no libraries.
There was no libraries at work that we could compile with Visual Studio 2013.
And Windows 8 APIs.
So. With the new Windows 8.1 API. So we set out to make a client to use to connect to X7PP and Jabber that supported OTR using the Microsoft
Windows APIs,
as well as an interface that looks cool with the snapping and all that stuff, with 16 hours of time to code, all from idea to now.
So we used, we didn't code everything, obviously, because it's too much work. So we used, we'll show you, the demo is so short, it's just like a chat. So we'll show you later. So we used XMPP library we found on GitHub. And everything here was compiled under the old version of Windows, and none of us know how to compile Windows. So we had to learn how to upgrade to Windows 8.1, which was a challenge. We had this chat interface, which uses the XMPP protocol, which we'll show you later, and the libotrc library, which doesn't use the new cryptography libraries for Windows 8.1. So we had to re-implement the entire cryptography library for OTR for Windows apps. So we'll put it on GitHub so anyone else could take it and clone it. It works really great, actually. So.
And then really quickly, not very important, this is just a security slide. If you guys are not familiar with OTR, what the security protocols, how it works, it basically allows two untrusted parties to securely communicate without actually having trust yet, which is Diffie-Hellman. If you guys are familiar, you can look it up. There's a cool page on Wiki on describing how it works without knowing any math. And then it allows you to do mutual authentication, which is really cool. If you can call your friend and say, hey, it says your key is this. Is that really your key? Then you can pretty much verify that there's no man in the middle. And then it encrypts the data in between the two mutually auth parties with AES 128 encounter mode. This is a standard OTR version 2 protocol, which we got working with a ADM client with our client. So we had feature parity with OTR version 2.
So we used XAML and C# to implement our interface, and that's actually pretty much it. And this is a Windows Store app, and so when we were sending messages, our client was able to read the messages, but Facebook, on the other hand, the web interface could not. That's why you see these encrypted messages all over.
Read your messages on Facebook for some reason, which is okay, I guess. But if you go on a Windows phone, you can read all these encrypted. You can explain what these are.
Well, this is just showing you guys. This is the ciphertext. So this is what the client would hide from the user. But this is, since his phone is plugged in to receive the Facebook messages, he's going to see the OTR. You can see the header there, that OTR colon, and then the ciphertext. And so our app actually intercepts that and then decrypts it and displays it to the user.
Let's show a quick demo. It's only like 10 seconds.
Really quickly, Facebook actually banned our IP because we had a little problem with communication, so we can't actually do a live demo for you guys, just showing the key exchange and
it might work if they unbanned us, but we'll see.
It's really upsetting to work that hard and then to not be able to show you guys the key exchange actually working. It's really freaking awesome.
Oh, you can't see this? No. Okay. You have an HDMI. It's okay. I think we can. Can you see this? No. Okay.
You can kind of see it.
All right. So let's do you log in. Log into yours as well.
I can't.
Log into ADM.
So Facebook actually blocks XMPP on their corporate network here, so you can't use port 5225.
So we have
something
to tether with our.
So yeah, we're actually routing our traffic through his Windows phone to do this demo.
It was working fine. We were happy like 2 hours ago, but we'll see. We have like 10, 20 seconds left. Okay. So we're enabling Ethernet sharing. Oh, there's no internet. going to enable your ADM?
Yeah, well, I can't tether to your phone right now. It's going to be a pretty boring demo, guys.
Okay, so...
You can trust us that it actually encrypts your communication. It's pretty awesome. And it works on Windows, so it's a library that you guys could use to build other apps on. So the time was not wasted, I hope.
Thank you, AT&T. It doesn't work. It works, but trust me, it works. But
really upset. I'm actually crying inside.
I'm crying. We work so hard. But it works.
Questions from the audience, please feel free to ask any questions.
The open source library will be available on GitHub. It works 100%. And it,
whoa.
It does. Yeah, we have a test client.
All right.
We have a test client. And yeah, hopefully the community will like the open source stuff we did for OTR. That's all.
So is this set up to just go over any XMPP?
It works with any XMP or
Java. Facebook, Google, Jabber. And there's no client like that that does like.
On Windows, 8.1.
8.1. Nothing.
That's really cool.
It took us like the challenges were basically.
Many.
Like many challenges. We didn't know how to like use the cryptography APIs. Like we had like 300 errors in the console to compile the library. We had to compile one by one and fix them. And the other challenge is like we had to learn like three different code bases. Like they're huge code bases. Like this chat app, it's really well designed, but we have to like go through it and learn it. And we learned a lot of new stuff in XAML and all the new async stuff that Windows has, crazy stuff.
That RTC stuff kind of nipped us in the butt a little bit, if you guys are familiar with that.
We spent like last eight hours trying to like figure out how to use the big state machine for RDC and sometimes like when do you send messages in the clear when like it was kind of difficult, but we learned a lot. It's a cool, challenging experience, so we liked it.
I just want to go to bed. So yes. Any questions though?
Did you have to use Win32 APIs for cryptography or
we use Windows.System.
We use Windows.System.Crypto.Cryptography, and when all the previous attempts have been in the previous
system
version,
System.Windows.
System.Security.Cryptography. And they're pretty similar, but they're different enough that Bouncy Castle stuff kind of relies on the old stuff, so we had to go through everything and redo all the SHA, the key, the hashing function stuff, so it was really fun.
So where's
thanks,
the
Microsoft.
Store? Where's the key store? I mean, are you... having your own key store with your own key?
So you can, it will automatically generate a key per session, but you can actually use your own DSA key, which we didn't implement that. So it will generate a key per session. So the idea was you could, if I was going to create a session with Mo, it would give me the fingerprint of his key, and he would call me and say, hey, this is my fingerprint. And then you could verify that there's no man in the middle.
Well, so you're not establishing OTR.
We didn't code that.
You're not establishing a trust. You're only ensuring that there's no man in the middle attack.
Well, yeah. The trust would be the fingerprint that he offline verifies with me through some.
But right now we're.
But I'm not trusting you, or I mean, I cannot trust that is the same person who's talking to me because it's not verified cert. Generating one every time.
I would say it is. If he calls me and gives me the fingerprint of the DSA key that it just generated, and then it was transferred in Diffie-Hellman, I would say I trust that it's him. But most people don't even do that step, right? Like, you can still man the middle OTR and just give a fake key and then sniff everything. Mm-hmm. So it's critical to do that. Hey, Mo, here's my fingerprint. But no one does that. So
right.
So our objective after this is to put the stuff we worked on the libraries on GitHub so people can reuse them. And hopefully they can use them on Windows 8 stores. And, yeah, that was really cool.
And
other people can create better apps than us. So we'll see how that goes. Okay, cool. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Okay. Hi, my name is Bikramjeet, I just want to tell you all that I'm actually very new to the Facebook world, basically, and so the real goal for me was to find out what kind of app can I develop for this hackathon. And so I settled on an idea, and I don't know if it's been already used before, and I called my app, like, On My Way, basically. And what this involves is that suppose I'm, me and my friends want to meet somewhere, or we are planning to, or we are already in some, you know, big exhibition grounds, and we want to meet at some point. So this app will let us know where are all my friends at this particular moment, and how far they are away, and so on. So let me just launch it for you. So and then I can explain the concept. So I did implement the new Facebook sign-in methodology, reading the blogs. So let me just sign in there. And this is that beta app it's using for sign-in. And so this is how it'll come up. Now, the map portion I've just pasted, that's not really coming from anywhere, but I just want to convey the basic goal. So the thing would be that my phone would give me my, using the GPS, the geo-coordinates, and this I would transmit to some backend system, and it could be Power, so it could be something on Windows Azure. And then I keep track, and I utilize the Facebook by getting all my friends list and creating a group which I want to really observe on the map. So that way, I'll be able to receive the information from my other friends also, their geo-coordinates, and I will basically plot them on the Bing map. And that way, I'll be able to know where they are at any given point of time in that in close vicinity or in farther place, and the distance between them. So this is basically the concept. And you can also provide an update status if you know, you're stuck in a traffic or something. You can do this. So basically, I've tried to integrate Facebook with mapping system and using the friends list from the Facebook. So that's the concept. Thank you.
How do you plan on getting the all the coordinates in real time from all the other friends?
Can you repeat that?
How do you plan on getting the your other friends' coordinates in real time?
So I guess my reasoning is that when there's a plan between friends, we already know that we are going somewhere, right? Mm-hmm. At that point, we can just there's no control here right now. But what I intend to do is provide a button where it'll get me a list of all my friends on Facebook, and I can just check box that I'm interested only in these people. And then the system is only working with those finite set of people. And likewise, my friends can do it too. And it's only, this app is only useful when you have a plan with your friends, and all of the friends then start this, and it starts running in the background and keeps on pinging the system with a timer or something and sending geo-coordinates all the time. Thank you.
You want to present? Go.
Yeah. Hey, judges can't present, dude. So what's going on here?
So yeah, I was pretty disappointed, and so were a few of my other Microsoft friends when we saw the rules. We had good plans
to start with.
Well, so given the chance that I don't get free time away from my family quite often, I decided to still implement it. Should show up.
Toggle screen. No DVI. No DVI.
It did show up there. The DVI. No, that should work. No, that's not. That's HDMI. It needs DVI, not HDMI. This should work, right? You don't have VGA?
Hello, my name is Alex. I'm gonna present to you Scab Hunt. This app is basically a fun socializing game where you take pictures, and I mean, you all have heard of a scavenger hunt. It's a scavenger hunt based app game, and it's connected to your Facebook, so you can have a scavenger hunt with the list of friends. essentially, you are around with a lot of environments, and you want to take pictures of, I don't know, you have a list of, you have a list of things to you need to take a picture of. So let's say you have those lists, and your friends are competing against one another, and you're trying to take a picture of that object. So it integrates to your Facebook when you make an event, so it's connected through everything else. So once you're there, it sends out an invite to all your friends on your Facebook, and whoever joins, and that's basically it. Over here, there's unique places where you can take a picture of, and you're there trying to take a picture of whatever certain object. Here you have a time limit or a history of like when do you want to have the scavenger hunt and when is it due by, or it could be a certain amount of days a certain amount of weeks. The display would be more of like integrating where I took a picture of that and it's foggy and that's it. The list consists of certain things, and then you check off the little checkbox that's on the list, and then other persons have to look for other pictures that are there. Essentially, it's a fun game. You're trying to take pictures. You're competing with one another, and that's basically it. Yes. Any questions?
Do you win prizes?
basically, it's not for a prize. It's more like who can take a better picture of this, or integrating with other people, saying, "Oh, that's a really nice picture." Where'd you get this picture? And you integrate. You're in separate teams, and you're trying to compete with one another, taking who takes the better picture. Any other questions? No? Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
All right. A hack for a hack. We couldn't get the display working, so we hacked it. All right. So what did I think? So as I was coming here, I thought, Facebook, one of the best things I like in that right now is the graph search. It's really fancy, but I can't get my mom to use it, or many of my non-IT friends to use it. You gotta go start typing, and it's not yet available on the mobile phone. So wondering the Windows Phone UI and how we can optimize it. So I tried to break that down into, Facebook calls it nodes and edges, very complicated. I couldn't learn that in college, graph theory, very difficult. So I broke it down into simple thing, how to form a sentence. It's just a subject and a verb and a predicate. In this app, I got from a subject and a verb. I couldn't reach the predicate yet, but let's see. So I tried to use the Facebook SDK for .NET. Trust me, it's one of the most simplest thing to use right now. That's login. That shows up my profile picture. This is two lines of code, which is awesome. Then now this is where it gets interesting, where I tried to create a kind of a graph of my own where, what nouns lead to what verbs and what, and so on. So for example, let me start with the simplest thing, which is show me all my friends. There you go. That was the noun, and it shows the verbs, who read, tagged in my pictures, and so on. Around 230 of them, not bad. So like another noun is the pictures. Show me pictures, my pictures. So it shows a list of my pictures. Show you all of them. Around 36 of them. Let's see. And then now I'm going to go deeper. So show me my friends who are all tagged in my pictures. Comes down to just only four of them I have tagged. Let's go back. I can't see clearly. Let's go back. Say, show me my pictures where my friends are tagged. It's the inverse of that, right? So let's see. Should bring up these people again. There you go. That's my wife and me. So that's one of the persons I've always tagged. So, and it has come down to 21 of my pictures. So the model I made it, I think, and I could build on top of it, which is basically I would like to define more and more events. So I created a programmatic structure that will allow me to create a lot of, where did that go? Somewhere. Oh, there you go. Oh. There you go. So I created something like that where, you know, I create more verbs, I can create more nouns. And basically, I map this to the SQL statements that is already there. And I found some bug there, by the way. SQL works, and it returns me a security exception if the app has not requested for a requisite permission. But if you use nested SQL statements, and if the security permission is somewhere deep down in the nested SQL statement, I just get an empty array back. And I kind of banged my head on that for quite some time trying to figure that out. But there you go. That's my app.
I have a question.
Sure.
So you're kind of like diagramming sentences. This, how, like, do you expect to be able to dynamically generate that grammar?
Yes, you should be able to. Right now, it is. I've created a tree mapping. I've created the mapping in code right now, where it says that a verb can have. I mean, a noun is associated with these verbs, and you know, and then backtracking back. But then if I'm able to put grammar. You know, just like any language, even computer language or a typical English language grammar, then I will be able to generate that dynamically. And in essence, it's basically, since I'm filtering down, all I'm doing is taking the results of one and applying it, you know, with an additional filter and going on. So,
that's cool.
Thank you.
Hey guys, so can we take a 15-minute break and we'll decide how we're going to steal these Xboxes, and we'll come back. See you guys later. Okay, I don't know if it's been 15 minutes, but I'm pretty sleepy. So before we go, I just want to say thank you all for coming. It was a pretty awesome hack. I hope you guys had a pretty good time, and at least learned some stuff. This actually was, at Facebook, we do these hacks all the time, and this was actually one of the fanciest hacks we've ran. It's the first time I didn't have to help arrange the furniture, so that was really good. I'm gonna Sanjeev announce the prizes, and then just gonna do a quick wrap up logistics, and then you guys can pass out or go drink or whatever you're planning to do. Okay, go for it, Sanjeev.
This live? Yeah. So one thing I want to announce before we start giving out the prizes. I want each of the teams, like if you plan to submit any app, I have dev tokens after the conference, like after the prize ceremony is over. If you want, just stop by and I will hand you out a token. So the store registration fee will be waived for you. So all the teams that presented.
Oh, awesome. So free money.
Yep.
That's pretty good.
All right. So how about we go alternating?
That's fine.
You can announce the first, I can announce the second.
Okay, we're going to start from
the top.
Fifth runner up.
Fifth. Yes.
We had a lot of good. So I'll tell you, I'll tell you one. So last night it was, or this morning it was like 5 a.m., and there were like four people here. And I was really worried about what we were going to see. And I was really, 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 really impressed. It took us, we didn't have enough prizes to give. So really good. So applause, hand for yourself. It's really good. Okay, number five, Palm.io. Come up and get your stuff. Oh, there's also these posters. We have a habit of making posters at Facebook. There are a bunch of them lying around. You guys are welcome to take them home. Pick one, anyone.
Go ahead.
You sure, one you like.
We have to demonstrate that your app runs on that.
They're all the same. So we decided to stretch it out a little bit since we had some excess capacity. So
so these guys are getting, the Dell Venue Pros, Venue Pro 8. It's pretty awesome. Just 1 second.
Two,
and then
three. Yeah, go.
All right, so the fourth prize goes to Eventbrite.
Whoa.
One in.
I'm pretty sure he already has a free store coupon.
To give out, so, not just to have.
So,
all right. Go ahead.
If you want to pick, I'm just going to pick somebody randomly now. No. Oh, okay, I get the hard one. Well, we're going to give this one to CypherChat, but we can only give it to one of you three because you other two are traitors. No, you other two work for Microsoft. So you can come up, and we'll take pictures and pretend like these boxes are not empty. But it was an amazing app to make it run across clients, and I want to use it.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
I don't know if you want it. Yeah. Oh. Thanks. Congratulations.
All right. So the second prize, and this one goes to. Where is the guy? Party host.
Ooh.
Can you look there and smile?
All right. You're gonna. I can.
There you
am
go.
I Vanna or is he Vanna? I forget.
All right, thank you. So that leaves the last one, and go ahead, Naren.
Okay, so here's what we're giving out. Here's a swag. Man, this is a lot of swag. Xbox One, extra controllers, some kind of game.
1 year.
A free year subscription to
Xbox
Live Gold. There were three. One of them went missing somehow.
Yeah, we don't know where that is.
Go.
Okay. All right, so the first prize goes to Oracle.
Oracle.
Oracle, come on in. And claim your Xboxes.
I'm not picking that up. That's pretty heavy.
Oh, yeah, it is. So there you go.
You can have it.
There you can have it.
One there.
What are we doing?
And go ahead.
Pictures?
Yeah, let's do one picture. Here. Just 1 second.
Thanks.
I don't know. We
can we?
Here, I'm just going to photobomb this. Okay, go.
There you go.
All right.
Ready? I'll try not to have the mic in there.
All right. Thank you, guys. And there you have it.
Awesome. Okay.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks, guys. Congratulate everybody.
Way
out. Okay, so one thing. I want you guys to give a hand for all these amazing folks who stayed here with us overnight, sitting and working the sound and all that stuff. Nicole, where are you? You're pretty awesome. Thank you for organizing this. If you would do these guys a favor and throw away whatever random scraps, there's like
around
stuff. Final thing. There are bags and bags of T-shirts at the back of this room. So help yourselves. If you got one early in the morning or late last night, whatever you call it, please try to give priority to other folks who hadn't got one.
Yep. And finally, guys, thank you, everyone. Really, really appreciate you taking the time off to come here and hack with us. We hope to see you soon sometime.
Next hack. Everybody's. It's like sharks feeding on T-shirts. All right.
Awesome. It was really fun. Thank you.